The future of wind energy will be beautiful, magnetic, odd-looking, inspired by nature, silent, inflatable. Wait a minute. All those articles are at least 5 years old, and all those technologies went precisely nowhere. Actually, that's not quite true, because some of them went to jail. More about that later. But there have also been a heap of new wind turbine technologies that are changing the industry. So I don't want to get too cynical and just reflexively reject any unusual ideas we see. I get so many comments asking about new wind turbines that are presented as the future of wind. So that's why I wanted to make this video as a guide to how you can tell exciting new wind turbine technologies apart from dead-end ideas that aren't likely to do anything except for give journalists and YouTubers a clickable headline and maybe also relieve investors of their money. I'm Rosie Vance. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. To predict the future of wind, I think it's helpful to look to the past. I've got this amazing piece of wind turbine history that was published, the second edition was published in 1980, and it contains a surprising number of design ideas that are being promoted as new today, over 40 years later. And I also got in touch with Paul Gipe, who's been following wind turbine trends over that same 40-year period since this book was written. Since 2003, Paul has been running his website windworks.org, and he's also written 7 books, including his latest one, Wind Energy for the Rest of Us. So in this book and on windworks.org, he has sections on small wind turbines, vertical axis wind turbines, and novel designs. So if you flick through those sections, and I think that you will find designs that are remarkably similar to nearly every single exciting new wind turbine technology that we see reported in the media recently. And the best part about Paul's work is that he has documented these devices from the initial hype through to real operational field experience, failures, bankruptcies, and in some cases, even jail time for fraud. So after over 40 years watching the next big things come and go, Paul has identified a few red flags to watch out for. Let's see what he has to say.
Before we begin, there are some important concepts we should introduce. Concepts that should be used to evaluate the claims of any promoter of a new wind turbine. One is the proof necessary that something is indeed new and that it works as intended. Another is the impossible demand by inventors that skeptics prove that their inventions won't work as planned. Astronomer Carl Sagan popularized the skeptic's credo, that extraordinary claims demand extraordinary proof. That is, anyone asserting that their new product or invention is far superior to wind turbines that we know work at reasonable cost has a very high hurdle to overcome before any journalist, politician, or investor should pay any heed. The most important tip to keep in mind comes from German professor Robert Gosch. If there is a new wind turbine, no one should pay the slightest attention to it, and that includes the media, until they build it, measure it, and publish a result. Until then, it's just hot air, marketing hype, and nothing more. How can you identify a questionable wind turbine design? Well, here are some tips. High hype, experience low, or non-existent. Is this something that's suddenly all over the internet, on Facebook, and in YouTube videos, but the company is a startup and hasn't been building wind turbines for years? That's a dead giveaway. Aggressive marketing. Look for multi-level or pyramid schemes of the get in on the ground floor and get rich variety. Celebrity endorsements. What do celebrities know about wind turbines? New designs. Not like those other wind turbines. As we've said, it's unlikely to be a new design. It might be new to the inventor or to the promoter, but not new to the people who study wind energy. Most likely, we've been there, done that, and moved on. New patents. Patents mean absolutely nothing. Darius patented the Darius or egg beater wind turbine, and yet he never built one. He did build wind turbines, but they looked just like every other wind turbine. Slender blades spinning about a horizontal axis. Drag devices, or I like to call squirrels in a cage. This is a perennial favorite because it's so easy for us to visualize the wind pushing on a cup or flat plate. It's much harder to picture how a modern wind turbine works. Modern wind turbines work on the same principle as the wing of an airplane. Yet many of us board airplanes even when we don't understand how the wing keeps us in the air. We know it works. It's the same with wind turbines. The wing of a modern wind turbine is much more efficient at capturing the energy in a wind than a big cup or flat plate inside some fancy shielding device. And modern wind turbines are much cheaper to build. Ducted turbines. This is another common new design, using a shroud or giant funnel to concentrate the wind through the turbine. Millions have been spent on these designs, and for naught. They are not as cost-effective as conventional wind turbines, despite the claims of being more efficient. Vortec, Flow Design, Ogen, and many others, they have all failed and lost their investors' fortunes. No hardware, but a fancy website. Websites are always cheaper than hardware. It's a lot cheaper and easier to build a website than a working windmill. As Dr. Gash says, if they haven't built one, tested it to international standards, and published the results, it's just a fancy website. Works in low wind. What do they mean, works in low wind? It turns? Okay, it turns, so what? Does it generate electricity? And if it does, how much? The answer is always disappointing. There's no energy in low winds, at least at the wind speeds these promoters talk about. Is it silent? Another dead giveaway. No wind turbine is silent. If they say it's silent or low noise, just what is the noise level? Noise is a characteristic of all wind turbines that's subject to complicated and expensive measurement. And these measurements have been standardized as part of the certification of wind turbines that gives the results in dBA under certain conditions. If they don't show this, they don't know it's silent or not. Does not kill birds. All wind turbines can kill birds and bats if they fly into them. This is the most despicable ploy of promoters to win the hearts and minds of those concerned about the environment. Small wind turbines kill few, if any, birds because, well, they're small. Measuring how many birds or bats a wind turbine kills is very difficult, expensive, and time-consuming. Most small wind turbine manufacturers, even legitimate ones, can't afford bird studies. Unless they've done such a study, no promoter of a wind turbine can say their wind turbine doesn't kill birds or bats.
Those cover nearly all of my own personal red flags, and especially the one about birds. I hate that so much. It's pretty much mandatory for a new wind turbine manufacturer to say how it's safer for birds. And since I am a huge bird lover, it makes me really angry that normal wind turbines' impact on birds is usually overstated. They kill far fewer birds than cats, cars, and buildings, and climate change is a way bigger threat than the expansion of the wind industry for pretty much all birds. And I will add that it's not just the bird claim that goes along with small wind turbines. Small wind turbines of any type need smaller foundations, have less visual impact, make less noise, cost less, generate less electricity because they're small. Okay, so yeah, that has all sounded a little bit negative. Maybe it seems like I'm saying that vertical axis wind turbines and other new small wind turbines are basically scams. And I'm not trying to say that at all. There are many good small wind turbines, including vertical axis, out there. It's just that they tend to get lost in a sea of really dodgy designs. Take a look at some customer reviews for small wind turbines and you'll see that in so many cases, people aren't getting what they were promised. And I really hate that someone was really enthusiastic to make their own wind energy and instead they bought a dud and they probably hate the whole concept of wind energy after that. So the reason why I wanted to get Paul's input for this video is because of his long history of following the wind industry and documenting the hype and crash of dozens of companies over the decades. If we look at what's been tried and failed in the past, we can get a better idea about whether there's any reason to revisit these old ideas now. I mean, just because an idea has been around for a while doesn't mean it can't make a comeback now. But is there a reason why this time would be different? Have technology advances addressed the challenges of the past? Is there a modern application or a new market that didn't exist the first time around? If not, then I think that we should consider that history is likely to repeat itself. You can check out the WindWorks website to read what history has to say about how hyped up new wind turbine designs have measured up to expectations. And you can see which ones have ended in bankruptcy. There's quite a few. And Paul has a cautionary example of one particular company that was especially hyped, complete with celebrity endorsements.
In the early 2000s, a company peddling rooftop ventilators as wind turbines claimed their product would produce nearly 5 times more electricity than a conventional wind turbine of the same size. The company asserted that they were thinking, outside the box. They certainly were. They were not even close to the box. They were on another planet where the laws of physics don't apply. In 2013, a grand jury indicted the inventor of this wondrous device for fraud. He was arrested in 2018 and extradited to the United States, appearing in a Raleigh, North Carolina courthouse in an orange prison jumpsuit. And here's another example. In the spring of 2014, Urban Green Energy, or UGE, announced with much fanfare that they had completed third-party performance testing on a new product, the Visionaire wind turbine. UGE crowed that the test confirmed that the turbine is twice as efficient as several of its competitors. You may remember UGE. They were the folks who installed two wind turbines inside the Eiffel Tower. So how does the Visionaire product stack up against a conventional wind turbine the same size? Well, not so well. Despite UGE's height, the conventional wind turbine was twice as efficient as the Visionaire at extracting the energy in the wind at the standard wind speed used to rate small wind turbines. Worse, UGE's own data confirmed a fundamental disadvantage of most vertical axis wind turbines. They are much more material intensive than conventional wind turbines. The relative mass of a wind turbine, a measure of its material intensity that includes the rotor and the nacelle, is often used as a shorthand for its expected cost. The more the relative mass of a turbine, the more it's likely to cost. The specific mass of UGE's vertical axis wind turbine was 4 times more than a conventional wind turbine. Have you heard any more about those wind turbines since? No.
So what does that mean? Should we ignore all small wind? Dismiss all vertical axis wind turbines as rubbish? I don't think so at all. Backyard wind can be fun, it can provide a valuable source of renewable energy where the wind resource is good, and it can be an excellent complement to solar in off-grid systems. I hope this video didn't feel too negative. I don't want to be a party pooper. I don't want to burst the balloon of anyone who's keen on renewable energy and making it in their own backyard. I just really hope to focus that enthusiasm towards technologies that are likely to actually make a meaningful amount of green electricity someday, or at least to not divert resources away from technologies that can. I noticed while I was collecting headlines for this article that many of them were phrased as a question, which I think is a neat way to get the sensationalism of a bold claim, get that clickability, but without technically endorsing the company's questionable claims. Have you heard of Betteridge's law of headlines, that any headline that ends in a question mark can be answered by the word no? Well, it seems to me that that has never been more applicable than on the topic of weird wind. Thanks so much to everybody who supports Engineering with Rosie on Patreon. If you'd like to join the community, then we would love to welcome you and help shape the future of the Engineering with Rosie channel. I'll see you in the next video.